thank you so much, everybody. We have a specific way in which we're going to operate this roundtable, and it's going to be done by everybody raising the questions, taking 2 or 3 minutes that they think are most important, most critical in understanding Occupy and its significance for working people in the United States and throughout the world. So I'm going to start with Marina, if you don't mind.
Okay. So what we're going to do is actually we're going to say a little bit about kind of who we are and locating ourselves and then raising our questions. So I've been a part of Occupy in New York since actually August. So before we occupied, we were in New York City General Assembly and actually had no idea we were going to occupy. A lot of us didn't even bring sleeping bags to the park. And you know, my background is having been a part of social movements and then later, you know, loving teaching and deciding to kind of study them as well as be a part of them, including, and in particular in Latin America, the more horizontal social movements like in Argentina and Mexico. So, you know, and I've also then in this last year in particular, in addition to being a part of Occupy, I've spent a lot of time in Greece and in Spain, movements that are really similar. And so just kind of framing the way I see Occupy and in Spain, the way they talk about the movements is that it's like a clima now, like a climate, less a movement and kind of a way of being and relating, and that's a lot of how I think about Occupy. So when I'm talking about it, I'm not talking about it as a thing or even it necessarily as a social movement, but as a kind of way of relating. And the main characteristics for me are, you know, the assembly form, the face-to-face, you know, horizontal relationships that we create, forms of direct democracy, and forms of direct action. So we're going to do it ourselves. We're not going to look to institutions of power to do things for us. It doesn't mean no relationship to them, but that's not where we think the answer lies. We're with ourselves and each other. It's self-organization. And a critique of hierarchy and power over, looking at, you know, that also not being the kind of form that we're looking to, which then for me raises this question that's really important for maybe the discussion we can talk, you know, kind of more in detail about, you know, maybe you'll talk about it more with Chicago, kind of how folks who've been participating in Occupy are relating to, you know, labor, and what do we even mean by that? Because I guess for me, I think of just like working people and how are we relating to people, you know, how are we relating in struggle in relationship to bosses and a class relationship, less an institutional union relationship. So that would be my question as well, is that how, you know, we got endorsements, for example, of Occupy from trade unions. But we're actually just relating to workers themselves and relating to struggles and going in and using our bodies to help block workplaces, for example. So the question is how, as this climate, this feeling, the spirit that is Occupy, how that then relates to groups that have more hierarchical forms, and some of them are really fighting organizations like the Teachers Union of Chicago. So what does that relationship look like in moving forward?
Okay, I'm Jackie Smith at the University of Pittsburgh, and when Occupy started, I had been, I've been doing work on the global justice movement for many years now, and being active in the World Social Forum process, which is very much along the lines that Marina was just outlining, very much a movement that is characterized by anti-hierarchy and horizontalism and participatory democracy and a critique of all the things that Occupy was starting to draw attention to in the United States, but which had obviously had some resonance before. And I've been very active in the National Planning Committee of the U.S. Social Forum, and so had learned a lot about how groups can come together and learn to work together across differences. And finding new ways of structuring meetings and working groups in ways that don't reproduce the hierarchies that are so characteristic of the capitalist society that we live in. So the racial and gender hierarchies were really reversed in the U.S. Social Forum process in some really important ways. And how many people went to the U.S. Social Forums in Detroit and Atlanta? So you saw what the result of that kind of organizing is. So the most diverse political gatherings in the United States, I think it's fair to say that that's what these were. The leadership was intentionally people of color, poor people, women, and you could see that in the character of the social forums. And so when Occupy started in Pittsburgh, I went to some of the early meetings and was rather shocked that there wasn't the same, at least, commitment to trying to transform the hierarchies of our society. And there was, even though there was this, in my view, a wealth of knowledge about what we call in the social forum process intentionality. So thinking about how do we undo hierarchy, and it really means moving from what the World Social Forum has been called an open space, so creating a space for participatory democracy. There's been a recognition that when you do that, power invades that space, and so you really need to be intentional in your process and think about how is power operating in our movements, and you need to actively reverse it and fight it, confront it. And that wasn't happening in Occupy in Pittsburgh and many other places. And I found it a very alienating space in many ways. The GAs actually very quickly, women stopped going to the GAs, and I stuck it out because I thought that we had lessons to bring in to this movement, and we already had movement in motion that these new folks that were coming in through the Occupy effort could learn from. And so what I did in Occupy was really try to bring some of these lessons from the social forum process to folks in Pittsburgh. It's a slow process, but I guess that would be my question, is how do we connect these new upsurges of protest with long-standing traditions and knowledge and practices and people and networks that really are the power of the left. I think that's the real challenge where we find ourselves in Pittsburgh and many places. But I think we have a lot of knowledge to draw from, and I'd like to have us think about how we bring it together.
I'm Walter. I'm a graduate student at the University of Illinois in Chicago. Up until last month, where I'm now working full-time, I've been in my dissertation. I was in the Graduate Employees Organization, which is the union that represents grad workers at UIC. I was in the Occupy Chicago Labor Working Group, and then that transitioned to the Chicago Teacher Solidarity Campaign. I, like with a lot of people, was really excited when the Occupy movement got started. It was kind of a long overdue return to economic radicalism as a movement. Because we've had lots of movements in this country, but we haven't as an economically radical movement. We've had civil rights, women's rights, gay rights, issue movements, anti-war, pro-choice. But this was a long overdue return to economic radicalism. So I went down, and that's why I got involved. I went down to return this because a lot of my background, I was as an undergraduate at Indiana University of Bloomington, in the mid-90s, it was the Decatur, the Staley workers lockout, the Caterpillar strike in Decatur, Peoria, Illinois, and then the Detroit newspaper strike coming up here. So it's always love coming back to Detroit, because this is kind of like one of the origins of my own economic radicalism. So I was glad to see the return to that. And the Chicago experience was different, I think. That's why I'm glad to see we have like a diversity of cities represented up here, and I'm sure we've got a diversity of cities represented up there, because the Occupy movement, a lot of it was different in a lot of different cities. For example, in Chicago, we never had a tent encampment. And for a lot of people, that was seen as a weakness of Occupy Chicago. Why can't we be like Zuccotti Park or Detroit? All the major cities had tent in smaller cities. Fort Wayne, Indiana had a tent encampment. All these smaller cities had tent encampments, and we didn't. And we tried 2 weekends in a row, but we're about to know the infamous Mayor Immanuel right now. They cracked down hard on that 2 weekends in a row on October 15th and October 22nd, arresting hundreds of people, which just a few weeks ago they were all cleared of the charges because it was unconstitutional. We knew that then. It took them a year to come to that. So it was seen as a weakness that we didn't have the encampments. But then I actually think that turned into a strength of Occupy Chicago. Because instead of having an encampment to defend and the central place, it forced us to reach out in all kinds of other ways. And so we had very strong committees in Occupy Chicago. And then one of those was the labor working group, the labor committee of Occupy Chicago, which there was some resistance to begin with, because Occupy was a rejection of the status quo, and labor unions were seen as part of the status quo or just appendages of the Democratic Party going along with it. But there were so many rank and file unionists and workers that showed up that were part of Occupy, you couldn't keep us out. Part of it. And so we started a labor working group. And what it did was kind of part of the Occupy umbrella. Political differences and everything were not tolerated. I mean, if you wanted to keep on battling the old sectarian battles, you had to go do that someplace else. And so it really brought us all together and it formed a network of radical trade unionists and non-union workers in Chicago. And we met every week continually, up even now in different forms, still meeting every week in Chicago. Meetings that I started with 100, but it was heard between 55 and 65. Rank and file workers meeting in Chicago, and this we were different than what was going on. The GAs and things were going on. We kind of went by more the traditional what a union meeting should be run like. It was very democratic, and basically a space for rank and file workers to get together and discuss their problems, their ideas. We had a workers' power conference that attracted 260 people at the end of January. We were involved. We politically led a lot of ways to let things in Occupy Chicago. Occupy Chicago was diverse, like a lot of Occupies. But one of the things, we were the only major Occupy center that in the United States that did not call a general strike on May 1st. We won the argument in the Occupy Chicago General Assembly from leading from the labor committee. We said, what is a general strike? And just doing the education, that you can't just call a general strike. I mean, we know there's a lot of labor historians here. And we had those political discussions, like, yes, we're going to build a broad demonstration, but we don't want to like fool ourselves about what a general strike is. And one of the things we did was we reached out and we made it, because previously, May 1st has become an immigrant, it's always been an immigrant, but recently it's taken on the immigrant rights mantle. So we did that in the previous year in Chicago, not it just happened, it wasn't any like political differences, where the main trade unions, they had their May 1st, and they had it at the Haymarket, and that's where most of the trade unions went. And then there was the immigrant rights group had a separate rally. So there was two separate May Day events, and Occupy Chicago helped bring it together. Again, so we had a solid unified May Day. And then what happened once we had the NATO protest to kind of sustain us, keep us going, that to focus on, which a lot of other Occupy centers didn't have something like that to guide and build towards. And then, of course, we had the CTU struggle. And then the Occupy Chicago Labor Working Group, we morphed into the Chicago Teachers Solidarity Campaign. And then we just heard a speaker about that, and you're going to discuss that a little bit. So right now we're faced, what do we do? The Chicago Teachers Union struggle was a big success. There's still the fight needs to continue. They're looking at closing 100 schools. The fight to defend public education is very important. But at the same time now, but there's lots of fights going on. Walmart, except at other people's workplaces. The Ron Emanuel was going and cutting back on everything. So that's our question. Like, what do we do now? Do we reconstitute ourselves as the Occupy Chicago Labor Working Group? Do we call it something else? Do we go into something else? Do we split? What's the next stage? Which I think is what we're all asking.
Colleague Kilibarda, I'm coming from York University. My PhD work is currently on labor struggles in the former Yugoslavia and the Balkans in particular. And I'm particularly interested in the way histories and legacies of self-management get taken up by workers. But I'm coming here today as also an organizer in Toronto, a community organizer who's been involved in a range of struggles since the mid-90s, I guess, since high school, basically. And what I'm here to talk about today is a paper I wrote in the aftermath of Occupy. What I was particularly interested in was the way calls to decolonize Occupy were taken up in several Canadian cities. Here in particular, I'm talking about Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver. So what I did, I interviewed a lot of activists that were on the ground involved in these three cities in efforts to decolonize Occupy's framework. And what the decolonized perspective does is essentially question the Occupy movement's emphasis on a kind of broken social contract without addressing the underlying racial contract that underpins the social contract. So this is kind of saying, you know, it sounds like, and it sounded like to to a lot of people in Canadian cities that the Occupy movement was saying, we have to fix this broken American dream, or the Canadian equivalent. Not sure if there is exactly something like that, but let's just go with that for now, right? Right. So many people, in fact, for many people, their experience is actually that there was never an American dream, right? It was always an American nightmare, and here in particular, I'm talking about Indigenous peoples. So I looked in particular how Indigenous activists and Indigenous solidarity activists took up this call to decolonize within these different spaces. This took many forms, from doing sit-ins to having actually decolonized tents, which they set up in Montreal. So taking up spaces within Occupy to kind of forward this analysis. Most of the activists I spoke to were pretty disappointed in the results. Some significant changes were made. Occupy Winnipeg, for instance, actually made Indigenous solidarity and support for Indigenous sovereignty in North America foundational to their basis of unity. But of the 40 or so websites and Occupy sites in Canada, only 6 or 7 even mentioned Indigenous sovereignty or Indigenous self-determination, which seems to be a very great oversight. And this is particularly significant because in Canada, prior to the Occupy movement, when you'd hear the term Occupy in the media, it usually meant an Indigenous occupation, or what they prefer to call it is land reclamations, right? So blocking bridges, taking over government offices, occupying parks and lands that are still disputed. And you know, if anyone from Detroit, you probably know better the history here in Detroit itself of a contested territory, right? So I think one Occupy organizer in Vancouver put it really well, right? When she asked, what does it mean to occupy space, or how can we occupy space without at the same time recolonizing it, given the settler colonial history that we're talking about, right? So this is maybe a question we can take up on the panel or in the discussion. During my interviews, also other things came up that I just briefly like to mention and echo some of the things Jackie mentioned. So those are the differences within the 99%, the power relations that exist within the 99%. And I think, again, here, looking at a community organizer in Vancouver, Harsha Lalia, who said, you know, ignoring those differences doesn't actually make them go away. It doesn't produce unity. All it does is actually entrench these differences further. So that's something to consider as well that I think is really important. And a final question that kind of came up through the discussions was the way in which social movements that pre-exist in the spaces that Occupy popped up in related to Occupy, right? And the degree to which Occupy was willing to work with pre-existing social struggles in these cities and the kind of complex relationships that, you know, did develop. Of course, eventually, in the cities I was looking at, a lot of the Occupy movement did kind of redirect its energies from keeping, you know, these 10 cities towards joining, you know, anti-gentrification campaigns, for instance, in Vancouver that were really important. They had an Occupy Condos campaign for a while, which I thought was pretty amazing. And they also had, you know, in Toronto, they joined the Stop the Cuts movement, which was fighting municipal budgetary cuts. In fact, Toronto's mayor just went to Chicago to visit Immanuel to talk about garbage. Apparently we're sending our garbage to you guys. So anyway. And in Montreal, a lot of that energy went into the Quebec student strike, even though, of course, that student strike has other legacies it's also drawing on, right? So anyway, these are some of the issues that came up with these discussions, but I really did want to center that bit of the piece, right? Are we only talking about a broken social contract, and are we going to address actually the racial contract upon which these separate colonial societies of the United States and Canada are founded?
That's right.
So, Paul?
Hi, I'm Paul Mishler from Indiana University in South Bend, and I was active in Occupy. We had a decent-sized occupation that went on for most of the fall, but most of my work before that and during that was linking up the labor movement with community organizations, and in that kind of context did that work with Occupy. I'm a historian, so I'm going to actually ask some different kinds of questions which is whether the history of social movements in the United States offers any kind of insight into what Occupy was. And I think one of the problems with the discussion of occupation, and I think we're all sort of caught in that, is that there was an enormous enthusiasm for the upsurge. And it was really wonderful to see all this sort of electricity of the spread of the movement from Zuccotti Park throughout the country, and sort of happening in South Bend, Indiana, was really amazing. Yet, that enthusiasm seems to have cut off sort of critical discussion about what Occupy actually was. And I thought, you know, I'm a historian, maybe I should do my job and look at other kinds of upsurges and see if there anything we can learn from this tendency in the United States to have these kind of momentary upsurges around issues of economic democracy and what kind of problems those upsurges have had. And so my thought initially was that, you know, the obvious one is American populism. And for those of you when I was first thinking about this, I was actually somewhat more positive about the populist tradition. After hearing Jerry Horn, I think we all need to rethink about whether there was anything positive about American populism. But one of the things that it's worth looking at is the emergence among, populism emerges among white small farmers in the South. At a particular moment where the recognition of the sort of agreement between the two main political parties in a pro-corporate kind of compromise really sort of pushed them in towards making a new political party and sort of expressing their independence from all existing institutional forms. The problem was, and I think this is sort of very telling and it comes up again in Occupy, is that an explicit rejection and ignorance of and insensitivity to the relationship between the African American community and the Republican Party in the years after the Civil War, and a kind of contempt for the relationship between the African American community and the Republican Party, which was a severely sort of made it very, very difficult for populism to actually carry out the goals that it set itself. Now, there were two areas in which populism sort of overcame this, both in Georgia and in North Carolina. In both cases, they were met with extreme repression. Tom Watson in Georgia organized a sort of anti-Ku Klux Klan night riders who had white farmers riding through the countryside defending black farmers. And in North Carolina, an alliance between the People's Party and the mostly black Republican Party took power in 1896 and were promptly violently overthrown in the only really successful coup d'etat in American history when the government of North Carolina was overthrown by the Democratic Party Ku Klux Klan alliance. But almost everywhere else where populism emerged, the relationship between the populace and the organized sectors of the African American community was contemptuous in a way that, in fact, we find among some of the statements of the Occupy movement. And this is where I am not I'm not quite as enthusiastic about what's being called horizontal organizing, because I think what it does it masks that a real kind of a disparagement of the history of struggle and organization on the two groups that are absolutely critical for making social change in the United States, which is the African American community and the organized labor movement. And furthermore, the kind of belief that it's the structured organization in the African American community and the labor movement that has prevented them from achieving their goals, rather than saying that's the opposition from capital that has prevented these organizations from reaching their goals, I think does a disservice to the history of social movements. And in fact, to the extent that white resentment against economic injustice does not recognize this historical role of African Americans as the focal point of the struggle for social justice in general, it is doomed for failure. So whatever the enthusiasm that many of us, had with Occupy, and the extraordinary success in the Occupy movement in terms of reframing the national discussion toward issues of inequality, all of that is really wonderful. But the anti-institutionalism, I think, has been a real disservice. One, because what are you going to do, right? I mean, Occupy was extraordinary for 3 months, right? And all of us who were in it, you know, it was great. But the institutionalization of power, of actually making change, was so explicitly rejected by dominant groups within the Occupy movement. And I want to just end with that it's also really important to understand that there were different tendencies within Occupy. So there was a very articulate anti-organizational sector of Occupy, which I think did a great disservice to the movement. But there were also, as the brother from Chicago points out, there were all kinds of people who got drawn in who were not as hostile to the traditional organizations, and the traditional organizations of struggle were not hostile to Occupy. It was very, very critical, I think, that the attitude of the organized labor movement toward Occupy, in the face of, I think, you know, really kind of obnoxious hostility toward organized labor responded, and this, what's very critical is Richard Trumka's decision to call the state feds and say, look, we don't know exactly what this is going in a good direction, throw your support behind it. And I think it was a really generous thing, because a lot of the rhetoric coming out of the Occupy movement was very, very hostile. And organized labor said, well, you know, we don't really care whether you like us. We're gonna support this. And then in New York, what's critical, and I know it has to be seen into the sort of what the success of the Zuccotti Park occupation itself, was the March of 20,000 trade unionists to support that. It's unclear whether that would have lasted beyond that.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Yeah, seriously. He can finish the sentence.
Yeah. So, my name is Chris Michalakis. I'm the president of the Metro Detroit AFL-CIO. And yes, I'm young. I'm 32. The youngest person to hold that post. And
what's your union?
What's that?
What's your union?
Oh, I come out of United for the Commercial Workers. And I was the legislative and political director for UFCW Michigan for about 7 years. And I just want to start off with one thing. Like, looking around the room, I see a lot of very familiar faces from Occupy Detroit that I've met over the last year or so. I'm probably like the least qualified person to talk about the movement itself, but I mean, I think I can give a nice, a labor perspective of what our role was and what I thought of it, the good and the bad. And, you know, initially, what was very unique about Occupy Detroit, I felt like we were, where Zuccotti Park was, you know, protesting, like an encampment where the top 1% live, we were the Occupy movement of the other 1%, the poorest 1%. And our encampment was really, really interesting, and very, I don't know, I had a great experience, you know, being part of the encampment, as limited as my role was. You know, whereas in Zuccotti Park, you had people picketing and protesting the foreclosures. The foreclosures were happening here, and we literally had people who were foreclosed from their homes with nowhere to live that came and joined us. And we started acting as this interesting crossroads of, you know, no matter what your political beliefs, you could show up and like, you know, you'd go on a Saturday afternoon and, you know, you'd have some, you know, the crazy Ron Paul,
it is the Midwest, right?
Yeah. No, but I mean, you'd have the Ron Paul people, you would have the LaRouche people, that's what I was thinking of, thank you. And then, you know, you'd have Democrats, you'd have not really many Republicans, but, you know, Green Party, you know, anarchists, whatever. And then, you know, as the night went on, as the day went on, you had a lot of homeless people that were camping out and Occupy and using us as a shelter. And you had this really interesting dynamic where, like, homeless people and people who grew up in the suburbs, like, got to know these people, like, built personal relationships. And I feel like made relationships and had conversations that would have never otherwise happened. The other thing I liked that happened early on too is right after the encampment happened at Grand Circus Park, which, by the way, we were in the shadow of Hazen Pingree, which is one of my favorite mayors in the history of Detroit. The just very progressive left-wing, you know, very anti-corporate, anti-monopoly mayor, and it was very cool that we chose that park to set up our encampment. But right away, there was this concern that you had a lot of white suburban kids, you know, finding it fashionable to camp out in the city. And we had these interesting dialogues with organizations that were in the city in a long time, you know, helping, you know, a lot of, you know, leadership of different neighborhoods and block clubs, meeting with these, you know, activists that were drawn to this movement, and like really having an interesting dialogue about, you know, what can we do to help each other out? What can we do to be inclusive? And, you know, even the name Occupy Detroit has this connotation that, you know, it, like an almost reverse a gentrification of the inner city. Something which, I won't get into that. That's a whole other discussion for another day. So it was really, I felt like for the first time we had a real honest discussion about what progressives across, you know, on either side of 8 Mile can do to work with each other and to really understand each other's issues. Another interesting thing that happened is, you know, we actually had like a decent relationship with DPD, and that really pissed off the anarchists. But I remember one day walking to the park, like dropping off some supplies, and a bunch of cops were sitting there, and I said, hey, you know, thank you guys so much for letting us do this. And the cops go, are you kidding me? You know how much money our pensions hit in Wall Street? We're glad you guys are here sending a message. And I remember the day after in Zuccotti Park where the New York PD came on horseback and corralled everybody. Well, the very next day we had a rally in Detroit and the DPD comes out on horseback. And it was like that scene from Braveheart where they approached the marchers, turned around and you know, led the way for us. And, So it was an interesting dynamic, and then we made, I feel like the community, or the movement itself made the decision to leave the park in the winter because we were acting as like an almost, you know, emergency shelter for folks. We didn't have the infrastructure and the ability, it would have been irresponsible of us to try to keep the park going through the winter. But what happened after that was this interesting set of projects. Eric from the Golden Gate Project, he, you know, started, went to this like block in northern Detroit and just like took over all these abandoned homes and started fixing them up and getting people to like move in there, and so they're, you know, taking back this neighborhood, and it just happens to be around the corner of my bookkeeper's church, and so she got excited that Occupy was moving into her neighborhood, and they, you guys connected more than a few times, I think, right?
So now let's actually go around and see if we can answer each of the key points.
Did he want to raise a question?
Do you want to raise a question?
Yeah, you know, I just, what concerned me, ultimately what I got frustrated with in the movement is we went from having 1,500 people in the first month of all of our GAs to now, I mean, I'll be honest, I haven't gone in a couple months to a GA. What happened and why haven't we asked ourselves, why did people leave the movement?
Okay, so maybe we should go around the same way and start with the questions that were raised. One is the question of hierarchy, which I think, I know several people raised. The question of horizontalism versus perhaps we can call the institutionalization of the movement. I think the question would be also, as appendage to that, some people said that the movement is over, talked about it in past tense. So maybe we can just raise that question first and then move on to some of the others.
I mean, the idea that Occupy is dead, I think, is also the way, and I'm not sure why this is happening, that Occupy happens and it's so inspiring and it's so different. And then within a certain number of months, we're looking at Occupy as if it's not different at all and we're measuring it like certain kinds of traditional movements, which I think it's not. I mean, as far as what was raised in bringing together the economic, political, social, cultural, it's not just an economic movement or just a political movement. It's this critique of saying, you know, we don't live in a democracy. You can't have democracy without economic justice, which was talked about earlier. And that's, you know, it's not said in those explicit terms, but that is what the movement has been saying. And so I think we need to think differently about, you know, where is the movement or what is it? Is it even a movement? Because, for example, like the question of housing, I mean, the number of cities and towns and villages where people are taking over homes and defending people's homes from eviction, using assemblies, having meals together, and it's, they're not all called Occupy, but they've all emerged in the last year. There's histories of this kind of organizing, the number of places. Let me just ask anybody you know anywhere. I have 10 seconds. Okay. So that's just one of many, many, many examples. And then the 99%, I just want to grab onto that as far as there are many critiques and we should have those critiques. But what that changed for me, and I think what's so empowering about it, is that it took away this guilt. You don't have a job, it's your fault. You don't have a house, it's your fault. We've changed the conversation and changed the conversation about power and where is power. And I think class is a part of that, but I think there are a whole lot of things that are part of that. I think it's just begun to open the conversation is what I want to say.
Okay, everybody will have 90 seconds, and then we'll open it up to the everyone.
I think taking a world historical perspective on this moment is useful, and in this sense, the Occupy Wall Street effort is really part, just a little blip, in a moment of world revolution that we might trace back to some time in the maybe 90s when it started. And Occupy is a moment in that movement that has opened up some space for some new mobilization to sectors that perhaps haven't been integrated into this movement in the past. And just one bit of data that I think is really relevant for us to celebrate and build upon is that a colleague and I traced some of the media coverage of the topic of inequality in the US media with regard to Occupy mobilizations, and has found a significant, you all know, significant change in the discourse that has persisted despite declines in participation in Occupy. And we also compared that with Tea Party media coverage, and there's some interesting patterns, and that article is on Common Dreams, so you can look that up, but it's I think we should build on that and think about movements and moments. And the movement is something that's building over the last decade or more and continues to.
I really like that Paul from South Bend brought up the historical context, because what I'm actually looking at my dissertation on is the continuities and evolution and agrarian radicalism. So of course, populism is a big part of that. And I think it's important to look at that in a different context, way different. But there is a comparison. I mean, Occupy, in a lot of ways, was a populist movement, just like the old populist movement. And despite being the rhetoric and just the panels have said, and just how it changed the dialogue, that we can talk about these things, that we talked about on economic issues, guilt that means you're unemployed, and we can talk about it. It changed. Occupy has changed that now. People are talking about this now. But at the same time, just like the populist movement tried to, it didn't use the rhetoric of the 99% versus 1%, which I think is very useful, but it's been brought up. I mean, there's a lot of differences within that 99%. And just as the populist movement tried to speak for all farmers, it failed because there were big differences between all those farmers right there. But then what came out of the collapse of the 1890s populist movement was the only time we've had a mass socialist movement in this country. So that's what I think is now, what do we do? What do we take from Occupy? How do we go forward? How do we build from that? I think what we kind of did in Chicago by relating to a teachers' union struggle and advance and the fight that won right there. And so I think that's why we draw these historical lessons, and then what do we do?
I think, if I'm not mistaken, during the last presidential debate, we do watch it under the border, Obama did mention 98%. The 98% he spoke wasn't exactly the 99%. So, but congratulations. Clearly, movements can't change discourse, right? But it doesn't mean we should rest on our laurels, right? We can keep changing the discourse. And just to pick up on some of the themes that I was kind of hitting on, one important thing in the sustainability of occupations, of indigenous occupations in Canada, right? Land reclamation. Some of these have lasted for years, right? Is actually how inclusive they are within the community. In fact, if you look at a lot of the Haudenosaunee, or better known as Iroquois, land reclamations that have occurred over the past 20 years, clan mothers have a really central role to play in terms of determining strategies of how to maintain these occupations and how to go forward. So you have both men and women in the community actively participating in decision making. And in some of the interviews I was doing, something a lot of activists raised was concern about the division of labor within the Occupy sites, right? Who's doing the decision making, who's kind of doing the mental labor, and who's doing the manual labor on the site. And in fact, in Vancouver, this got really ugly because it was a lot of the homeless folks, a lot of women, a lot of folks without university education that were left doing the food preparation, the cleaning up, the peacekeeping, etc. And what happened is actually the tent city voted to separate from the General Assembly in Vancouver because they were like, you're not including us in your decision making. So again, I think we can look to indigenous models of organizing, we can look to other models of horizontalism or verticalism even, or other models of governance that I think have a lot of lessons there, especially for maintaining occupations for more than just a month or two, right? And through the winter in very hostile conditions, right? So there's a lot of like even concrete practical lessons to be learned. And finally, what I want to say about discourse is a quote from Andrea Smith, and I'm just going to paraphrase here, where she asks, why does it sound so absurd that we would talk about indigeneity in opposition to genocide? It doesn't really complicate our analysis. What it does say, however, is the fact that a lot of people find this silly or preposterous or too radical to talk about these things shows the degree to which we've internalized genocide in this country. And so I think that's something worth thinking about, taking Andrea Smith's words and kind of thinking further along those lines in terms of how can we change that discourse so that we start talking about the contested sovereignty of the lands we live on.
I think it might be useful to problematize the relationship between process and substance. And there's been kind of a tendency in American social movements over the last 20 years with this kind of assumption that if I feel participatory, if I feel good about my participation, that's enough. That's like winning. And I think that's problematic. It's not like winning. It's an experience. And winning is about something else. And I think that we need to problematize that discussion, not because the experience of participation in social movement is not worth anything, it's worth a lot. It's how people get brought in, it's how people transform themselves. All that is really important. But to not open the question so that every time, I mean, I remember both in reading what was going on in the occupation, hearing from other people who were involved in occupations across the country, that every time a matter of substance was raised, the answer was, my experience is this. Not, for example, I mean, for a movement that was so many young people and so many people who were facing debt crisis, that there was no united demand for debt relief. People talked about lots of things. There was all kinds of critique of what was going on, but there was no consistent demand that was going to be mobilized around actually winning something. And I think that just needs to be a problematized discussion. What is the relationship between the process of participation, which is important for bringing people in, for solidifying, for changing people's minds, and winning real demands that change people's lives for the better. And I think that that discussion in the context of Occupy needs to happen.
You know, in Detroit, I saw there's two things that happened. On the one side, you had these great projects, like the Golden Gate Project, Occupy Our Homes, all these home foreclosure fights, the 5900 Project. I mean, a lot of really good, positive things. Another interesting thing, too, I want to point out, I met a bunch of other people who work for unions in the process of the Occupy movement, and it really led to a little more cohesion amongst young, progressive union, you know, establishment people, dare I say. And we've done a lot more to advance our ideals within the labor movement, I feel like. On the other hand, I feel like in Detroit, and I'm sure this happened other places, we put process over progress. You know, we were more obsessed with following a procedure, and you know, like, when you call yourself the vanguard of the 99%, you have to be responsible on how you use that title. You know, 99% of America doesn't want to have a 3-hour-long discussion about the virtues of communism. You know, like, and what happens is that you become you exclude people who don't have the time, quite frankly. You know, you exclude working people. You know, when you have these like 3-hour-long meetings that don't end in an action, it excludes people. And you know, people have lives to live. People have kids and families and work.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Okay, what I'd like to do is have everyone who wants to ask a question, maybe they could come up here so they can be heard if you don't mind.
My name is Rakiba Brown, and I am a participant in Occupy Detroit. We actually adjourned our General Assembly early so that we could be here at 2 o'clock for the round table, and so some of us are here. So what I would like to say, first of all, is that when we were encamped in the park, most of our guidance came from the organizers of the 2010 social forum, people at Michigan Welfare Rights, because they're across the street from the park. And so they came over, Mary Kramer, Maureen Taylor. She came over and they told us they actually had homeless people talking with the people who were running the camp to let them know that, you know, these tents, the way you have them, is not safe. You know, this is really a different way for you to design it, and they had homeless people actually out there looking out for the kids who were sleeping there, because the very first day we had a lot of problems, you know, because what happens in a movement like this is that it is so novel that people don't know how to think their way through it, and people don't know how to think about 99% being so diverse. You know, that nobody in the 99% is alike, you know, so you can't have all these things you're accustomed to. That was the same thing with horizontalism. People have read about it, and they've had study groups about it, but they don't know how to do it, you know. And so for all the things that we went through the first year, and I think we shared this with a lot of occupations. I went to Occupy London Stock Exchange in England, and it was the same way, you know. They were doing a lot of really nice things that we didn't know about. So one of the things I think the movements have done very well is use social media to kind of keep up with each other, because I really love the things you're saying. It's like, oh God, they did that in Winnipeg, they did that, cool. You know, and so, and I remember looking on Toronto's site, they were having lots of workshops on race. I mean, lots. Whereas here in Detroit, we probably, you know, we couldn't really handle it. I mean, we knew it was an issue because you go to the GA and it's the majority of white people. And, you know, you go to any action and the majority of white people, which is why myself, I felt I had to be there, you know, because it is an idea whose time has come. But for people to try to understand how these white kids relate to you, you know, they don't know. And the white kids themselves who ran down there, because most of them, you ask them, where's Eastern Market? They don't know where shit is in Detroit. You know what I'm saying? Like, we Detroiters, we can't respect that. You know, so I can't believe your fight is my fight and you can't even tell me how to get to Eastern Market. You don't even know what the boulevard is. You know, we don't get that. And so a lot of groups, though, that's on the ground already fighting here in Detroit, they saw the promise of Occupy. It's like we can get a new kind of attention that we never got to our causes. And I do want to say our first General Assembly was opened by a Native American, you know, and it was on Columbus Day. It was on Columbus Day, okay? That's what it was. And so the whole issue of Occupy and what that word means, I also want to correct you on the fact that we left the park because they told us we could stay there 30 days. Our lawyers went to the city and National Lawyers Guild, so we could stay until that day. And then there was a decision whether or not to fight it. Okay, and we decided it's not worth fighting. It's just a park, you know. And so even though there was a lot of quote, so we just left, and you know. But the was tense bothers me when you talk, you know. Occupy was this, was that, but you're killing us off, you know. And I mean, seriously, because I have to talk to people in Occupy Detroit with that same issue because they don't do the work. They just look and count numbers. But you see, we have organizations here in Detroit like Housing and Human Rights. It's a coalition of people from Occupy, people from welfare rights, people from a lot of different things. And when they have a problem, they'll call Occupy. Okay? They're gonna call Occupy because now they know that Occupy wants to work within what's going on. Occupy wants to work on the issues. Occupy wants to work on what the 99% perceives as the change they want. And you got to be the change. We know we have to be the change, but we don't know how. So people are learning how, you know, and people who are not willing to learn how, they don't come. Right. Like somebody asked today, oh, well, can we appropriate like cash and stuff at this GA because it's only six of us today, you know, don't you have a quorum? Well, the quorum is who show up. So if you that concerned about how the money's gonna be appropriated, and I'm gonna say the labor union keeps our money, the labor union got us our first toilet, okay? I mean, you know, we don't have this problem, even though we have the discussion where people don't like labor unions, but this is a union town, so come to Detroit and talk anti-union if you want.
My name is Steve Babson, and I also see a lot of familiar faces here. And I just want to make it clear that the last Occupy movement I was at was not the General Assembly. I haven't been for some time now. That last meeting was 80% African American and about 20% white. And that's because we were focused on direct action around evictions and anti-foreclosure efforts. And one way we have been able to merge a sort of horizontalism with ongoing action and activity that keeps our meetings well attended, sometimes as few as 20, but often 40, and we meet every week, is that we are focused on the immediate concerns and direct action focused on the Paramount homeowners, on Jerome Jackson, on Jennifer Britt, and it keeps us going and focused and disciplined. And our meetings, we rotate the chair, we rotate who's taking the notes, we rotate the timekeeper, we make people who are reluctant nevertheless chair the meeting so that everybody, we move that responsibility around the room. In terms of the weekly meeting, it's probably 60-70% white. When we move into particular actions, it becomes predominantly African American. And I just want to wrap up by saying, well, this may be an approach that's worth, and I'd like to hear about other cities, how often you're focusing on eviction defense and foreclosure. We can win small skirmishes. We're still losing the war, but you can win small skirmishes, and nothing builds a movement like success, even when it's a small-scale one. We've had 10 campaigns over the last year. In all 10 cases, we kept those people in their home. Picketing the banks, we did it by picketing and drawing out federal representatives, asking them to act on our behalf. We did it by blocking the trucks when they tried to show up with a dumpster. We did it with a month-long vigil in front of, most recently, the home of Jennifer Britt. And I'm going to close by making this announcement. She was facing eviction by Fannie Mae. And increasingly, that's what we're addressing here now. It's less often now the bank and more often Fannie Mae.
Oh, yeah.
And yesterday, Fannie Mae, we forced them, and they just yesterday signed the deal. Jennifer Britt will stay in her home. It's no longer owned by Fannie Mae. Focusing on foreclosure issues and eviction, A and B. The issue of Fannie Mae is a complicated one because it changes the nature of the focal point of who our enemy is, or it adds another one to the mix.
Okay, my name is Stephen Boyle. I'm with the Occupy Detroit movement. I'm also with a few spin-off organizations, and I wanted to say that exactly what Steve Babson says, what's happened with Occupy is it's actually given us an activist push that didn't exist before, where people could actually get themselves aligned with like-minded people. Right now, I'm working with a lot of people around what's going on in Detroit politics. We're filing ethics complaints against our officials. We're sitting in and pressuring them during the meetings that they have. We're actively engaging in, we've actually got a proposal slate where we're talking about what are the issues that we're facing in Detroit. And we're facing something that we've affectionately called the dictator law across Michigan, Public Act 4, which we sadly have an attorney general and a governor that resurrected a dead law, which according to our municipal code says, or the Michigan compiled law says that we should not have any law that's been repealed brought back to life. So we're sitting here coming up on Halloween with a zombie law, keeping our emergency managers in place, and it's all about the creditworthiness of the state of Michigan. They're worried that if we go into Chapter 9 municipal bankruptcy, the creditworthiness of the state suffers. So again, the banks is where we're sitting. But it's a big picture. The beautiful thing that I'm seeing also is that a lot of people actually saw a call to action that one of our activists, Lee Gaddies, was saying right up front, because he's been politically active, is you may need to just not be so worried about running for political office and actually get into political office to be the catalyst that you seek to have. Hans Barbet, who's in our audience right now, is actually one of the Green Party candidate running in districts for more people that have come up through the ranks and are busy working with an Occupy agenda, and it's good to have the Green Party with their obvious support of the Occupy Party as well. I think that we are getting more options showing up because of the synergy that's happened, where people actually have an opportunity to just say Occupy to each other. And it almost is this code word that it's like, okay, the wall's got to come down for a second here. I got to find out what they said. Because it is. Occupy says, wait a second, it's listen. It's not about, tell me. It's like, wait a second, I got to listen for a second. Something's different here.
Yeah, so my name is Tristan Taylor. I'm with the civil rights organization BAM, which stands for the Coalition to Defend Affirmative Action, Integration, Immigrant Rights, and Fight for Equality by Any Means Necessary. And from the beginning, we saw Occupy Detroit as an opportunity to have a movement of people who wanted to fight alongside Detroiters to rebuild and defend Detroit. Because everyone has seen the absolutely egregious, non-media attack on Detroit. I mean, we've had over the past 4 years 150 schools closed. Every single public school that I went to in Detroit is closed. I can't even get a copy of my diploma of my wife because the high schools kept that. But you know, through the confusion, I'm really glad you brought up the thing about populism, because that's been my thing, because left-wing populism became right-wing populism really fast, and you see the potential even today of that. I think it's been through focusing on the concrete struggles themselves and asking myself, what can I bring, what struggles that I know is going around Detroit can I bring to Occupy Detroit to get the people who want their opportunity to make a fight for equality, to make a fight against injustice, what can I do to bring that, to give the people who want to do that an opportunity? I mean, we've successfully kept two libraries open, like in Detroit. We kept a school open. Like Steve Mapson said, we've kept stopped evictions from going on. Recently, you know, a lot of people showed their support for the city workers strike that happened, you know, not too long ago. And okay, yeah, these are small things, but they're definitely, especially for Detroit, where it's such a hard place to live day by day, a real ripple effect that we're looking to move forward. And, okay, there are some people who, like, you know, thought Occupying a Park was cooler than actually stopping people from, like, getting kicked out of their homes. I'm not afraid of polarization or people dropping off. Like, I want to know where people stand and not be afraid of that confrontation, so that we all know, because it's good practice that you know where people stand and their experiences. And so, you know, one of the questions I have for people is what have been those concrete experiences that they've either had or that they wanted to bring to the other occupies to consolidate a group of people. It may not start off as 1,000 and be the biggest, but people who can be really effective in the numbers that they have. Because, you know, in Detroit, we've had some real success in doing that. And also, just a FYI, if people want to know more about the strike that happened, I do have copies of the strike bulletins that go through, like, everything that happened. So,
We didn't start from scratch in anti-foreclosure because we allied ourselves with the UAW. It was very important in getting us going and giving us a lot of support, and still is important. And the contacts the UAW has are very important as far as like working our ways through the legal battles and whatever. And also, there's some lawyers who are just out there just plugging away in this incredibly overwhelming problem. And one of the lawyers, you know, when I met him, I sat in a counseling session, and he was so depressed he could barely, you know, counsel any kind of optimism. And now he's so optimistic. And there's a lot of people in neighborhood organizations that we're trying to energize a lot of existing people and a lot of existing groups. And that's one of the most rewarding things to me. The other thing is, I don't know if you all know about in New York, the Hot and Crusty Bakery.
Yeah.
And that was, do you know about that? Yeah. I'm just wondering if that, it's a small bakery. It was, the workforce, as far as I know, was totally undocumented. And they were, and when they decided to have a union, they wanted an independent union, and yet it was a lot of support from the existing union movement. And the owner, a financial person in New York, fired them all because they're undocumented. And they did win. And not only that, they got something very interesting, which is a clause saying that the company could not, the owners could not check the status, the legal status of anybody they hire in the future, not just for themselves. And I've just been looking around at organizing, and this firing of undocumented workers is just, it's a killer. And the fact that, and this is a small victory, but does it have any resonance? That's what I'd like to ask.
Actually, Hot and Crusty is a chain, a very large chain in New York. But that was one of their stores.
So my name is Hans Barbey. I got involved with Occupy Detroit at its inception. There are a couple of things I wanted to bring up. One was this question of horizontalism and institutionalization. I should preface by saying I feel like the labor movement is something that I don't fully feel that Occupy took had the, you know, the most ideal relationship with, and I feel, especially in light of these recent strikes, that the labor movement has such an important role to play in the furtherance of an economic democracy and whatnot, and what this movement is. So I would never want to downplay that. I do want to call attention to one incident over the past year that took place. It was during the General Electric protest. Downtown, General Electric doesn't pay taxes, despite, you know, ridiculous profits, and so SEIU actually was a union that bottom line a demonstration, and originally their intention was to shut it down. They had I didn't attend the meetings myself, but I was a participant in one of the, you know, 1,000 or so protesters that went down there. They had plans of the diagrams of the whole building. They were going to shut it down, and due to that, I guess, hierarchical structure, some key people like Debbie Stabenow and actually General Electric themselves offered a whole bunch of jobs to a related, you know, an affiliate union of SEIU, and Debbie Stabenow gave them a call. They said, fine, we won't shut it down, we'll just march around the place. And so there is an element of, and I think this goes even deeper, I think in society, through the educational system, which I kind of feel is obedience training in so many ways. You get your marching orders, you get your schedule, a bell rings, and you go to your next class, and you're told what to do, and that's sort of how we're brought up.
Yes.
And so I think a lot of what the Occupy movement is confronting is this element of, like, you know, what should I do? I saw this really great quip recently. It said, don't question authority, they don't know either. You know, this element, and even in the camp, there was this sense of like, what should I do? You know, what should I do? And it, you know, as opposed to taking initiative and finding a sense of leadership within oneself. You know, so that I think is something the Occupy movement is confronting. And it's not, you know, we can't flip a switch and just say, okay, everyone has personal initiative now. You know, it takes time. So fair enough. You know, I can handle that. The other thing I wanted to add, as mentioned as a Green Party candidate, I felt like, you know, that plays into it. There's this sort of looking up to candidates. I didn't run as a, you know, with a Green Party candidate. I'm not, totally disconnected from reality. I realize it's not going to win. It's the political landscape being what it is. However, it's a vehicle to develop that independent thought of like, okay, what's an independent, third party candidate, what's that about? You know, just to get the wheels turning a little bit deeper. And, you know, I'm someone who frankly believes that a constitution written 200 years ago has you know, less and less relevance, especially in the last, 10, 20 years, when technology being what it is. And I think that another thing the labor movement might think about confronting is the situation of, capitalism in the face of an abundance of information, technology, and resources, and automation of manufacturing and things like that, where, you know, the paradigm for capitalism is you need a low supply of something in order to sell it, supply and demand. And, you know, if we're going to, the reality is now that we have a lot of abundance of things. And so we're coming into conflict with an old paradigm and new tools. And, you know, it, again, question authority because they don't know either. And we're kind of having to come up with our own answers. And so I just want to put that out there as this element of like, how do we, take our own initiative and where are hierarchies relevant? Where is a culture of, personal leadership or leaderfulness, or instead of leaderlessness, leaderfulness, as it's sometimes, playfully taught. How do we develop that?
And I am a person who was involved in the 60s, Vietnam War. And a lot of us who come from that generation have been activists for a period of time. And all the people that were active with are our age, and we're all getting older. Or they came from the wave before us, which was the McCarthy period, the UAW organizing period. And now we have a new wave, which is Occupy. I think we have to talk about Occupy in the context of what's happening with the way mankind organizes itself in the planet. It's organized on the basis of capitalism. Capitalism, obviously, is deconstructing. This is not 1890, where industrial capital was supplanting agriculture. This is not the 30s, where we had masses of workers in Detroit, organized, and we had 100,000 workers at Ford Roof. This is a period where electronics and robotics are replacing workers, where we're moving towards production without labor. The issue is how are we, the working class, reacting to this situation, which is impoverishing us day after day? It's getting worse and worse for us. But we have reacted, and we've reacted. Part of our reaction has been Occupy. Now, people can point fingers at us and say, you should have done it this way, you didn't do it that way. But the fact is, this is a work in progress. And the fact is that people have come together who were never political before. People from the suburbs, from the city. And we just celebrated our one-year anniversary, and we had a whole flowchart of all the actions that we've been involved in. We have an infrastructure, we have activists, we have people. We're involved in all kinds of different struggles throughout the city. Every struggle in the city is connected to Occupy. That's what we've achieved in the past year. We were, there was a reaction against hierarchical organization, because we know the hierarchical organization that have existed heretofore, including the labor unions, which after their initial organizing period started to go right, including the Democratic Party, and all the institutions which presently exist in society are not stepping to the plate. They can't step to the plate because they're tied to capital. We are beginning an independent movement. Yes. We have to have an independent movement if we're going to seize the bull by the horns that's happening today, but we're becoming impoverished, and we've succeeded in doing that, and we're going to continue to do that. And I say three cheers for Occupy.
Brief
brief. My name is Laura Freeman, and I was involved in Occupy Detroit from the beginning. And it's been a really great thing for myself and for my family. As an older student, I went back to college when I was going through some personal trials and tribulations. I'm a working class female, had two kids at home, was in the wonderful position of getting to teach a class in Marxism at Scott Correctional Facility in Detroit. And then I graduated from college, and where do you go from there, you know, back to work, you know? But Occupy came along, and I got involved in Occupy, and my two kids got involved in Occupy. My daughter designed the patches you see people wearing. My son was the first Occupy Birkin to get arrested. And so I was very proud, and it fulfilled an extremely important need for people like myself who feel injustice and feel that the country was going in the wrong direction all the way from Nixon, Reagan, right down. But anyway, so where does it go from there, though? It fulfilled our needs, but I personally started a discussion group and got confronted. You saw Tristan here. There were Workers' Revolutionary Party people arguing with Tristan that what he picked was bad because it was Trotsky, and I got a deja vu about SDS, and I thought, oh no, this is what happens with the left. We do fight like motherfuckers, you know, like kill each other. Don't know how to get along. But, you know, being a woman, I was in a position of power in that group. Even though I really hated power, I hate the word power, but I knew that I was going to get up and say something to defend Tristan against these guys fighting with him. And I said, hey, whatever he says is right, because he's talking about where his passion comes from. We're all in this together. It's all just power to the people. And so that's where we're going. We are learning how to communicate across our differences, like you had mentioned. And we're trying to get it so that we actually do have a movement that doesn't focus on hierarchical differences, but rather focuses on the same similar needs and similar interests, and of making a culture of love and solidarity.
You know, first of all, we're doing it again. We're talking about ideological purity as opposed to like planning actions. And what I get frustrated with, you know, I go to Occupy, people hate me because I'm a Democrat. I go to Democratic Club events, people hate me because they think I'm an anarchist. You know, like no one knows where I am. And the reason for it is I don't care about isms. You know, like when you feed the homeless or you know, Steve, when you guys worked to keep Jennifer Brittner house, it wasn't a bank, it was a government entity that was keeping her out of the room. The solution isn't a theoretical process. You know, I think we need to start with actions first, and you know, our goals should be an equitable society. It should be fighting for equality, fighting for rights. And I think when we start clinging to this sense that some sort of, like, that there's a silver bullet ideology that's going to, like, lead the way, we're going to lose, because we all have different ideas on what that ideology is. I don't know where I stand on the spectrum, and quite frankly, I don't really care. And so I think that's a problem that Occupy has had. I think it's a problem we have in the labor movement. You know, people criticize us of being too attached to the Democratic Party. You know, sometimes that criticism might be warranted. And I think as progressives, we need to think beyond ideology and traditional ideological structures. And it's a big pet peeve of mine. And I also want to say this, I don't mean to be critical of anyone here, because like most people believe in what they believe in out of love and out of good intentions and for the right reasons. And I respect that. And so it's just, it's a big pet peeve of mine, sorry.
Well, we're not going to be able to address this today, but the labor movement is a big and amorphous thing, and I've been in it for over 30 years, and I think we have to be careful about sort of how we describe it and what it is that we're describing. So let me cut to the chase. The Chicago Teachers Union, which I hope the brother on the end and others will speak to, I think what our movement or movements is missing is organizers and cadre. And that's what we were really challenged by. And certainly, my experience in the labor movement is we've been pretty pathetic on that score over 30 years. And so while I'm up for the resources and some of the spaces that the labor movement may provide, I have no confidence whatsoever that at least the labor establishment is in a position to train us as organizers and cadre. However, the Chicago teachers strike people probably heard about this at lunch, but for those of you who didn't, it's a result of over 20 years of effort in the union to bring a rather more of a union forward. And 2 years ago, a reform caucus won in that union with a totally different approach to how to do the union work. And so I think it's important to study, because I think that leads to a core of 10 to 12 people were in that caucus that then were able to grow out from that in terms of member-to-member organizing and all sorts of cadre development. Had tests along the way over the last 2 years in terms of leading to what went on both in the bargaining and, more importantly, out in the streets in terms of that campaign. So I would ask people to look to that, because I think there's elements of that approach that are useful to any movement, and they didn't come out of nowhere. They came out of past social movements that this brother spoke to, that, you know, on some things I may not agree with him on in terms of how we interpret history, but I too am willing to participate in horizontalism, but I come to horizontalism with, you know, wanting to see it make an impact.
Yeah, it's very interesting hearing about all the different kind of actions, and I think that, you know, one of the things that however one got to these questions, that the issue that needs to be addressed now is reaching out to new people. That there are enormous constituencies that are suffering under the way the system is being organized now. And if the process of Occupy, which created new generations of activists, that one of the critical things, I think, is that people need to learn to go out into the world and figure out how to explain the critique to people who are not used to hearing their world criticized.
I guess, in terms of some of the specifics, because some people were like, what are the specific things that people have been doing? I think Marina, when she mentioned in Spain this word clima, right? Prior to Occupy in Toronto, actually, there was something called the Stop the Cuts campaign. And what this campaign did prior to Occupy was organize neighborhood assemblies, street level polling, organize people to do mass deputations in light of massive budget cuts that were coming in from the city government. And in fact, they had a 700 person assembly in downtown Toronto a month and a half before Occupy, where they put forward a People's Declaration of Toronto for an alternative way of running municipal governance. So it's really interesting to think about the kind of time or environment in which we're in which these things are happening independently of each other and also related to each other, right? And then when Occupy came, actually, a lot of the people that were involved in this effort were a bit thrown off, because these were new people that were coming in from the suburbs or from different, they weren't connected to this broader municipal movement. So it took a few months actually to readjust and rejig, and there's a lot of people that acted as bridge builders between these two movements to actually then by January make a big impact on the city council meeting that was deciding on the cuts, and we actually managed to stop $20 million in cuts, which was quite a success. There are still cuts made, but this was a big deal. When it comes to trade unions, and I'm just going to talk about the Toronto example, the rank and file was very involved. They were pushing, they were very much mobilized, they were excited and energized by the energy. A lot of youth were talking, we need to support the unions, we need to walk on the picket lines, we need to have these flying squads, which is there's a tradition of this in Toronto, to go and support the unions. What happened? The municipal union leaderships engaged in concessionary bargaining. This happened at the municipal level repeatedly, and this really took the wind out of the sails of social movements who were willing to support labor, because these concessionary bargaining tactics really, you know, took everything and all the cuts kind of made to wages, to benefits, all these kind of things, and that kind of dampened the movement. Finally, to go back to Indigenous issues in Canada, two struggles right now that are very salient. One that happened around the Occupy movement was a northern community, Atawapiskat, which the government actually tried to impose emergency management on, and the community said no. And they rejected emergency management, and people were doing solidarity actions with this community. So this was a very positive example. Another example that people are starting to talk about is child and aid services, which is taking Indigenous children out of their communities. Right now in Canada, we have more people in CAS facilities than we did during the residential school system, which was a genocidal system, taking Indigenous children out of their households, out of their communities, to raise them as good European Christian subjects, and to kill the Indian and the child. So now we actually have more Indigenous children in this. So there's a movement to get Indigenous children back into Indigenous communities. So while they may be taken out of their household, at least they're in the same community and they can still see their family members and be with them. So these are some of the things people are working on. So anyway, I'll pass it on.
Okay. I'm going to briefly, but I want to just talk about love, horizontalism, and workers' power. So in talking about emotion and how people have changed in the movements, I mean, this, to me, cannot be underestimated. And it's not just emotion mobilizes people. When we feel love and trust with each other, which is, I think, core, we're also more radical and more militant. I mean, this goes back to SNCC. This is what, you know, Grace Lee Boggs here has been talking about with Beloved Community, going back with Ella Baker. I mean, this is, it is militant, and it just makes me crazy when it gets relegated to like, oh, it's a woman's thing, it's talking about feelings. It's like, of course we have feelings, and that if we feel cared for and trusted, so it's a huge thing. Horizontalism, which, you know, is even a bad translation, but this comes out of the experience in Argentina, where after the economic crisis, people were using horizontalidad to just describe a social relationship. It's not a thing. And people talk about it as a relationship, and it's a changing relationship, and we make it where we are. So Detroit Occupy is making, you know, whatever that social relationship is, how you make it, and it's a constantly changing relationship. But it is about not having power over, and it's about empowering and having love and trust as a basis. But that doesn't mean organization is also something that can make me a little crazy. Maybe I'm just overtired. But, you know, some of the experiences I've had then to share maybe that aren't so much in the US, but in Argentina there are more than 350 workplaces, all kinds of workplaces, from factories to hotels to grocery stores to newspapers, that workers are running. And the vast, vast majority, without bosses, without hierarchy, the vast majority are run with horizontalism. They say that, with horizontalidad. And they have job rotation. And they're actually more productive in all kinds of measurements of production, you know, using capitalist measures and kind of different kinds of value of solidarity than traditional workplaces. So that kind of segues from horizontalism into workers' power and workers' control. And that's where I think the conversation should go. It's not, you know, yes, it's great working with unions and organizing, fine. But we need to go beyond that. And I think in Greece, this is another thing I'm going to be going actually in a week to Thessaloniki. Workers have taken over a factory and they're running it themselves, and they did it also in relationship with workers in Argentina, helping to talk to them about how they're organizing, you know, a horizontal workplace without bosses, outside, you know, kind of capitalist modes of production. So I think we need to think really big. I underestimated what we could do with Occupy, and we are so far. So as far as our relationship to work, I think we have to think beyond just traditional.
I think one thing that's missing from our discussion here today, which has been really interesting and very good, but it's very US-centric. And so earlier I said we need a world historical perspective, so not just the history, but the world is got to be the frame. And that means a few things. One is we have to think about our movements here in a context of US decline as a world hegemon. That means a lot, and it means, you know, trying to stem right-wing populism that is likely, and to prepare people for the kinds of changes that are necessary. So this world historical context, we're in a moment of crisis. Capitalism is in crisis, and it's not going to look good. It might be easier for us to get people to stand up and fight, but it's going to be a hard struggle. We've got to prepare people for that. So the world historical perspective brings that. But we have to help people analyze our own local context in light of a global economic system and a world system that needs to be totally transformed. So everything that we're familiar with, nation, race, class, gender, all these basic categories of identity have to be transformed. And that's where I think the World Social Forum process has really given us some resources to draw from in terms of new identities, new ways of thinking and discourses that we can build from and bring our analysis from the local to a more global context. So analysis is one piece we take from the global, but the other piece is the resources, the movement building resources. Networks, there's networks of groups that we can model and build with and connect with just to get that love and support and ideas and power, models of action, and new discourses. So in the World Social Forum, there's ideas that resonate with the Occupy movement, and we can point to movements all around the world that are taking up terms like when we did, good life as the way of organizing societies as opposed to growth being the orienting model, the rights of Mother Earth is another frame that's really inclusive, and it can help us bridge some of these historic divisions in our movements. Food sovereignty is another one that has been really a good frame for organizing that we can take from movements elsewhere. So bring a world historical analysis and framework to our thinking. And I'll just plug my journal that I edit. Journal World Systems Research is online, and there's some actually good papers in the current issue that do some of this, and I have cards to give you the website, jwsr.org.
We need to break down this. We need to continue doing more and more things like this. This is how we learn from each other and share our experiences. There was a it was end of April. I went to there's a labor conference in Chicago, and there was a panel on labor and Occupy. Jan Rodolfo, who's one of the national organizers of National Nurses United, and also she's an activist as well. She was speaking, this was a labor and Occupy panel, she was speaking, the main thing that she felt was holding Occupy back was the labor movement. The current state of the labor movement is what was holding Occupy back in a certain degree. She said, if there was an invigorated labor movement, imagine what that would mean for Occupy. This would be even more. And we got to see that in Chicago, is what we saw like that. We decided to take the decision, the one real truly functioning committee of Occupy Chicago, the labor working group, and basically kind of ended. That's why I say was. I'm sorry, I'm speaking about Occupy Chicago. It's great as Occupy Detroit going. It's great Occupy Wall Street still going. No.
Sunset Park, Kensington.
All yeah, no, it's great. It's all over. It's all a place like that. I mean, it's great. It's still going. I just prefer it to be Occupy Chicago. Honestly, it doesn't. We're out evaluating right now. But we saw what happened. It would be put into practice when there was a labor movement on the move in Chicago, and what it meant for Occupy, those of us that participated in Occupy, or that are and were a part of it, like that, and what it did, we took on and won against Obama's right-hand man. Return to social movement unionism. And Occupy was a big part of that right now. So that just gives you an example right now. That's one part that's important. The brother from the CTU is like, we need to go out and spread this example of what happened in Chicago. I mean, there's battles to still be won. I mean, it's not over yet. They're talking about, as I mentioned, they're talking about closing 100 schools. I mean, that's something you can't put in a contract, but that's a fight that's going to continue. CTU is going to be there. Occupy Chicago will be there no matter what form it is. I mean, I still have my patch on there, wear pride, and I'm a part of it. So we will be there. This is continuing. This is what Occupy has done and changed that and brought new people into that. And it was, I mean, of course, this goes back years of planning and preparation that the CTU did, but that there was Occupy came along, was a big part that made that victory possible. And so that's what they need to do, keep that lesson and keep on going from that.